gentlemen, and welcome to the Universal Amphitheater. Well, here it is, the late 1970s, going on 1985. You know, so much of the music we hear today is pre-programmed electronic disco. We never get a chance to hear master bluesmen practicing their craft anymore. By the year 2006, the music known today as the blues will exist only in the classical records department of your local public library. So tonight, ladies and gentlemen, while we still can, let us welcome from Rock Island, Illinois, the blues band of Joliet Jake and Elwood Blues, the Blues Brothers.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the DreadCast. I'm your host, DreadnautX. You can call me Dread. Today we have a special treat for episode 2. Our new co-host is joining us. Please welcome Joviah to the podcast, everybody. How's it going, Joviah? Why don't you tell everybody about a little bit about yourself before we get started here?
So yeah, my name's Joviah. I get asked a lot where I came up with that name, and quite honestly, like, true story, I was getting ready to play EVE Online, and I didn't have an internet name that I used. I didn't have a handle that I used on a regular basis. So my girlfriend at the time and I just sat down, and we wrote every letter of the alphabet, all 26 letters, and on a piece of paper, and just cut it up, right? So one scrap of paper per letter.
Yeah.
Threw it into a hat and just drew out six letters. And that was the order, like Joviah, like J-O-V-I-A-H. That's what came out of the hat.
It turned out to be a name that you can actually, like, say, you know what I mean? Like,
instead of
just jumble.
Yeah, you can say it. There were no numbers. I didn't want any numbers. I didn't want, like, triple X, you know, awesome gamer, triple X.
Right.
Exclamation.
Yeah, it's different, man. It's like, I've never heard it before. I thought maybe it had something to do with the gorilla or, you know.
Nope, the gorilla came later. The gorilla was specifically for Twitch. Like, when I sat down and decided, hey, I wanted to start live streaming, I commissioned a logo and all the stream graphics and everything, and I really wanted it to pop.
Yeah.
But I didn't want anything like overbearing. Like, I'm not a super competitive player.
Right.
So I wanted something that just kind of, you know, people would recognize the logo.
Mm-hmm.
And the gorilla is what came out of it.
Yeah, for sure, man. It stands out. It's not just a normal J. I mean, because it could be anything, right? It's kind of got like that personal touch to it with the animal there, and it stands out, right?
Right. Yeah. Well, my wife and I spent a long time figuring out what animal we wanted. and she came to me one morning and she said, gorilla. I'm like, gorilla? What are you talking about, right? I'm still sipping my first cup of coffee.
Right.
Like, I was thinking about it. You know, a gorilla, they're intelligent, which, you know, she thinks I'm intelligent. I don't know. They're intelligent. They're protective. They're strong. They're family-oriented. So that's – I'm like, you know what? That actually – yeah. Works. Gorilla would work.
Cool.
Yeah. So we told the artist – because the artist was wondering, like, hey – what do you want? Like, what do you want it to be? And I'm like, well, let's make it an animal. Okay, well, what animal? I don't know. So he gave us a couple days to think about it, and that's what came out of it. And we went through a couple of iterations of it, and it worked.
Nice.
It really worked. Yeah. So, yeah, I've been gaming for as long as I can really remember. I know the game that really got me, I mean, was Super Mario Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
We had a neighbor who was better off than my parents, and they had bought their son, who was like one of my best friends at the time, a Nintendo when they'd first come out.
Mm-hmm.
And we sat there and we played Super Mario Brothers. And at that point I knew, like, that I freaking love games.
Yeah.
I played any chance I could get.
It's crazy. It's crazy how Mario has that effect on people.
It really did. It really, and it's such a simple concept, right? Mm-hmm. It's like just a guy running on it. Nowadays, it's like 2D platformer,
yeah.
Like super simple concept. Like, it would never sell today.
Yeah.
But I mean,
the first Mario.
When you're growing up, and that's like your first thing that you get introduced to is Mario, man, that stuff is mind blowing.
Yeah.
You push a button and this guy does it on screen. It's just the concept of, you know, gaming itself back then to me was like incredible.
Oh yeah, and around the same time, my dad fairly soon after brought home a brand new computer. And I'm talking like these are one of those like refrigerator sized,
right,
old almond color IBMs with the two floppy drives, yeah, on the front, you know. And he brought home a game called King's Quest. And I got into that. Like, I was really young. Like, I didn't know what the heck I was doing. Like, I didn't recognize even some of the references, which are all fairy tale references. Yeah. And I didn't know what I was doing. So I would just die repeatedly in that game. But still, I really enjoyed it because I was just exploring the world and I was always finding new little things. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how to interact with them very well,
but still.
And I never finished it. But it was fun. So that was a thing. My dad also, he programmed mainframes. So he was always getting, you know, PC related magazines. And back in the day, PC related magazines would usually have like a whole snippet of code, that you could plug into your own IBM compatible PC at home and dabble in programming. So he found one in one of his magazines, which was, it was a very simple game where you would control an ASCII character and you would move it around on the screen with the arrow keys on the keyboard, and things would pop up on the screen, like, so power-ups or just, you know, not even power-ups at that point, just, you know, pick it up and you get points.
Yeah.
And the other thing that would pop up would be like, I think they were called noids, and you didn't want to run into the noids, so they would kill you. I spent hours playing this game. So that kind of introduced me to the fact that, like, not only, you know, there's Super Mario Brothers right next door and King's Quest on my own computer, but, you know, you could actually make games on your own. Like, this isn't magic. It's science.
Right.
So those things together really kind of got me going. And then, of course, you know, the Final Fantasies came out years later. I always promised myself, you know, when I grew up, I would be buying my own consoles and stuff. This is what I wanted to do as a hobby.
Yeah.
So I played games as much as I could, basically all through high school. And then immediately after I moved in, my parents had separated at that point, and I moved in with my dad, and, I got a job working in a warehouse. It was actually a pretty nice warehouse, like air conditioned and everything. It's not like one of those crappy warehouses. It was, yeah, pulling electrical components off of a shelf. So it was pretty cushy. And all of my money was going towards building my own computer and buying video games. And one day my dad, I guess he'd had it. And he came storming into my room one night and he says, "You've been playing," like, I was playing X-Wing versus TIE Fighter at that point. And he's like, "You spend all this time on that game. What have you got to show for it? Like, what are you doing with your time?"
Yeah.
And that one statement, the way he said it and the way he approached me about it, really made me think it through, right? Because at that point I was only doing it as a hobby, and that I think is the point in my life when I decided to get into IT, which I've been doing my entire professional career,
right?
And I actually went to school a number of years later when I got the opportunity to actually be able to afford college. I went to school for video game software development, and it was like the hardest thing I've ever done, but I made it through. And I always think back, it's like all this time spending time playing games. Now I have something to show for it. I have a job, I have a college education, and now I have a small channel on Twitch, but I get to share that joy with other people. So there you go. That's how I spend my time now.
That's incredible, man. That's pretty awesome when you, you know, when you're growing up and you find something that you're into, and then, you know, most people would just play games and just enjoy games, and then to take it and to, like, have that drive to, like, you know, take that stuff in college and get into the IT aspect and just, you know, do all that stuff that kind of blends it into the rest of your life instead of just making it like a normal small little hobby like, you know, most people would make it, right?
Right. No, I think it's well, it's been an amazing experience so far. Who knows where it's going to go from here, right? I'm not sure.
Yeah, you never know, man.
The funny thing is my wife doesn't play games. which she has an iPad, which, you know, doubles as a Candy Crush machine.
Right.
And that's the extent of her gaming.
Yeah, if you want to sit down and play some Clash Royale with my wife, no problem. If you want to sit down and play anything else, yeah, it's good luck.
Yep, exactly.
I mean, I got her. Yeah, go ahead.
She deeply respects the hobby. Yeah. And I've introduced her just like, I've showed her some streams on Twitch. Like,
yeah.
You know, Co-Carnage, right? I'm like, sit there and just count, like, for an hour. Just sit there, honey, and count for an hour how many subscribers he gets. Mm-hmm. And so she did that. She actually did that. And she came back with some crazy number. It was like 100 or 200. It was one of his better days.
Yeah, I think. Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, now multiply that by 2.5. And that's how much money-ish he made during that hour. And she's like, holy crap. She's like, holy crap. Like, yeah. What can I do to help? I'm like, I don't know.
If I knew just, that answer, yeah, I'd be set.
Yeah, and like, just support me and love me and don't divorce me.
Yeah, no doubt.
Right. So, yeah, but I she actually went to TwitchCon with me this year.
Oh, nice. How was that?
And
is that your first time?
It was amazing. Yeah, it was my first time ever going to a TwitchCon. I mean, this is my first year ever streaming anyways. I started back in February, yeah. So I never would have thought of going to TwitchCon until now. But I did go. I met some great people. I met up with some other streamer friends that I've met during the streamer journey, I guess.
Yeah.
And it was an amazing experience. There were so many people there. It was crazy.
Yeah, I always say, like, it sucks being in Canada and, like, because all the big cons are down there, right? Like PAX and TwitchCon, and it's like, I'm always stuck up here in Canada. There's nothing up here, right?
Right. Well,
a con in Toronto, but, you know, it's like, it would be different if I had people who to go with or to hang out with, right? But my wife's not huge into that scene, so, and now with the kids and stuff, too, it makes it difficult to just be like, yeah, I'm going for a whole weekend and spending this amount of money and, you know, just to go check out some video games. It kind of, you know, family's got to come first, right, for me here, so.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, well, family always needs to come first. But
yeah, for sure.
I think, you know, my wife, when we got out to TwitchCon, like, she knew that Twitch was big. What she didn't know is just how big. Like, yeah. I told her, I'm like, expect the crowd. When we walked up on day one and we saw Ninja had a bus and probably about 20 employees all wearing and hawking his gear to people standing in line, the thousands of people standing in line.
No way.
I think at that point, she realized that, like, Twitch is a thing.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's going to go anywhere.
No doubt. Like, I mean, there's no signs that it's going to be getting any smaller. Personalities are getting bigger and more people are becoming more popular and it's getting out there in mainstream more. And yeah, it just seems like it's blowing up.
Well, absolutely. I mean, there are a couple of threats on the horizon. That you've got Article 30 out there in the EU, which could be a problem for creators, even podcasters, YouTubers, live streamers. You know, any type of content creator.
Yeah.
Even if you're just a regular artist, like a traditional artist,
mm-hmm.
Some of your stuff is at risk there. But that's a whole discussion.
Yeah, I thought I read something about that before too, just briefly. But
yeah, it all has to do with copyright infringement, but nobody really truly agrees what exactly that means. Mm-hmm. Like, and it rolls into fair use and some other things, but like, essentially, like the EU and the I think the music industry primarily out there. I don't know much about the EU and how it totally works, but right. I do know that you know, the fair use policies out there could go out the window with Article 13. Like, just the fact that you are streaming or putting your image on top of an image created by somebody else could be a problem. And I think Twitch is, there are a bunch of live streamers out there, including Twitch as a corporate entity, is pretty afraid.
Yeah, that sounds pretty intense.
Well, Article 13 specifically states that those, like YouTube and Twitch and any other like website that allows content creators to upload their stuff, that YouTube and Twitch would be held liable for any copyright infringement. So along that comes basically anybody that wants to claim something can claim it, and then, you know, YouTube or Twitch would be stuck paying a fine, which would get severely expensive and put companies under.
Yeah, it's like, where does that leave everybody? Like, so what's this article? What's like the date, the time frame for this thing? Is it still passing through? Or,
well, I think they recently, that's something I don't specifically know, but yeah. I think they recently passed the final, like they voted on what the final version would be, but I don't know if they passed it to like
on the floor, becomes, like, so it's out there, yeah.
Right. And the way it works is this is the EU Parliament. So this is the governing body over the EU.
Yeah,
it doesn't go into effect even for the EU. I think the way it works is each individual company would have to pass their own law, or not company but country would have to pass their own laws to put that guidance into effect. So I don't know. It I guess here in the States, it would be like the federal government saying every state would have to do this, but rather than it becoming law, the states would have to enact their own stuff.
Yeah, like who's going to go through that trouble?
Exactly. So, you know, either depending on how bad it gets, we would either have to keep things, we would either have to block folks from the EU from watching some of this content or accessing some of this content, or just stop doing it altogether. I mean, can you imagine like a world without YouTube right now?
Yes. So like you're talking like people from the EU just can't stream, or are you talking like
not only stream but watch a stream?
Yeah.
Like half of my most, I would say 80% of the people that watch me, just because of the time zone that I live stream, they're from the EU.
That's crazy.
So yeah, I don't.
I was just assuming.
I don't think that it. I don't like that.
Yeah, that's crazy, man. Like, I just assume, like, you know, when I'm in a stream or something, other people stream. I just assume most people are probably from the States and one or two people from Canada. But yeah, I guess, I mean, a big population of the world is in EU as well, right? So,
absolutely. Yeah, and depending on what your, you know, what time frames you stream at, you could get a mix. Like, I get a mix of folks from the States and in Canada, here in North America, South America. But when I first start my stream, it's mostly, you know, folks from Europe that come and join me.
Well, you tell me which time zone stays up till 4 a.m, and that's the one I'll go after.
Well, I was up till 4 o'clock this morning chatting with a guy in Hawaii who joined us for our show last night.
Nice. I'll go after the Hawaiian market. That sounds great. I love pineapple.
20 people out there.
Pineapple on pizza. I'm good.
You could learn to speak Japanese or Mandarin, and you got it.
Oh yeah, I'll just look up one of those. I'll get one of those earpieces that translates it for you on the fly.
Use Google Translate a lot.
Just give me 5 minutes to repeat everything back to you once I've heard it. Be a little bit laggy on my stream, but we'll get through.
Right. I can only imagine the logistics of that.
Yeah, it's you're always trying to stream as it is too. On top of that, right?
Right. No doubt. Yeah, you have to do it as much as possible.
Oh shit!
So what are you playing these days, man?
Man, it's my time playing is so little, I can't get into anything. I've been playing a little bit of Destiny here on the computer, Destiny 2.
Okay.
Just because it's, yep. I find the controls been pretty awesome on the computer, so I haven't, my subscription to WoW has lapped. I've been back into Hearthstone a little bit the last few days. I've just been messing around. I've got Spider-Man that I've got like 5 minutes into. Red Dead I've got like 10 minutes into. it's this is like my gaming life. It's I'll get a game, like look, you know, Fallout 4. Like it's a huge game. Skyrim.
Right.
I play Fallout 4. I do a couple missions. I get to Diamond City, and that's as far as I've gone on Fallout 4. Now I've spent all this time building up these cities and putting all these defenses in place. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to wait till the mods come out, and then I'm really going to play this game. Oh, yeah. You know, I go in and pick up all the stuff in the houses, right? And I get over encumbered. I'm like, it's so annoying, you know, not being able to pick up all this junk, right? Yeah, it's part of the
game. You're a hoarder too.
Yeah, exactly. And it's I know it's part of the game, but it's just something I don't enjoy. So it's like, you know what? I'm gonna wait for the mods to come out. The mods are gonna come out soon. So the mods come out. I get this mod that lets me pick up as much as I want. It gives me a ring or something. That lets me pick up as much as I want. I play it for like five more minutes. I don't think I've been back on. I don't think I've been back on since, man.
Now I have too much stuff.
Yeah, it's like I need an inventory mod now. What do I do with all this stuff? I got, you know, I have all the DLC for the game. That's why I stopped buying DLC. It's like I have all the DLC for that game. I've never seen any of it because I'm still like level 10. I'll cheese my way through the first like, you know, there's a glitch where you're like, you put down the special book and then you pick it back up right away, or you get your dog to pick it up. And you can copy this thing over and over again. So I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do this. So I spent like 5 hours copying this book over and over again, maxing all my abilities. And then when I'm done, I'm like, hey, I'm Superman. I don't want to play anymore now. I'm bored.
There's no challenge.
Yeah, it's exactly.
Challenge is gone.
It totally ruins it for me. I mean, I had Game Shark back in the day. It was the same thing. Like I plug these codes in and it would just, I'm bad for it. It's I have this itch to do it. And then when I do it, I totally lose interest. Same with Skyrim, you know? I created a character. I got to, like, the first town. I went and did, the first dungeon or something and came back to town. It just, I don't know if it's those type of games like that and Fallout. I have Horizon, which I spent, like, maybe about 13 minutes on. You know, I don't know if it's those type of games, but it's, like, I get into it and maybe I get too overwhelmed with how big the world is or how much systems there are in the game. And it just, you know, it's like I can't keep up between the crafting and all this stuff. It's just, I don't know if it's too much or.
I was gonna say it sounds like it's. I get this way too. Like it gets overwhelming. Mm-hmm. Like Skyrim, you know, I mean, there's tons of, like, even with no DLC or anything, mm-hmm. Skyrim alone, vanilla Skyrim is massive.
Exactly.
And you just be walking down the street and all of a sudden you find this epic quest, or at least at your level, it might be epic. And it sends you off to this, what seems like a massive dungeon, which may or may not actually be massive, but it's the fact that it was there and you never would have known it was there except for this one little snide comment from this guy that you passed on a road. Yeah. Right. And that to me, like, I think that sort of compounds for me, and the game world just becomes, it's probably all mental, but it just becomes huge, right? Yeah,
exactly. And I think also
coupled
with the fact that the games are so huge, and you know, it gets into my head that like, oh, there's just too much to do, is the time. It's like, you know, having the two kids now, working night shift, I'm literally like stuck like maybe half an hour a day during the week, and then on the weekends I have to stay up till, you know, 12-1 in the morning. Like my wife goes to bed, and then if I want to go get some sleep, I'll go to sleep. But if I want a game, I mean, this is what I have to do, right? To game. So, I mean, so I'll stay up for a bit because I don't care about sleep. So I'll stay up and play some games. And it's like, yeah, it's like, I know I have to spend all this time and these games take so much time. And it probably like deters me from like sitting down and getting into like Red Dead that much, or getting into Spider-Man, or, you know, all these other games. That's why it's like lately it's been, oh, I'll jump on Hearthstone for a couple minutes, or 5 minutes in Destiny, or more games, Dead Cells, more games that I can go in and spend 20 minutes with, and then not be in the middle of a quest and have to be like, oh, well, my time's up and I gotta figure out where a save point is or get out of here, right?
Right. Dead Cells was an amazing game for just pick up and play.
Exactly. And it seems and
you
like
just pick it up. But that's a huge game too.
Yeah, well, I'm not that good, so I just keep playing the first level over and over again.
Same here. Like I suck. I'm terrible at it, but I was watching somebody play Dead Cells who had like 400 hours in it.
Jeez.
And he had like, I didn't even know what he was talking about at the time. He had like three boss souls or something.
Yeah.
So he, which was essentially like new game plus, plus, plus. And he's going through and he's just, he's basically just sauntering his way through the game. And I'm like, dude, no, this would take me forever. It took him forever, but you know, he was like, oh, this is easy.
They make it look so easy. I love the game though. It's a great game.
It is. It's fantastic.
It's like, it took me man, it must have took me like a 100 tries, 50, 100 tries to beat the first boss. And now it's like every time I get to him.
I haven't even seen the first boss.
See? And now I get to him, and every time it's like, oh, I can probably beat him if I've got a pretty good loadout. But it's like, yeah, it's just playing that much, and it's like, oh, I'm never going to get better at this game because I suck at it. And then eventually I finally get enough to like, oh, I could probably beat the boss now like maybe 60, 70% of the time. So.
Right. Yeah. See, that's good. Like, I just did a recent playthrough of Blood. Like, I bought Bloodborne when it first came out. Like, this game looks amazing. Plus, I was a Dark Souls fan, so, you know, of course. I played it. I think I got through the first boss, maybe the second boss. And then just, you know, another game came along, and I was on that bandwagon.
Yeah, yeah.
And just sort of sat Bloodborne to the side. So DLC comes out a couple years later. I'm streaming on Twitch, so I decide, you know what? It's time. It's time to beat Bloodborne. And that was... I think playing Bloodborne with folks chatting with me in chat and giving me hints, but not spoilers. You know, hey, have you thought about doing this? Or have you thought about doing that? I think that was an amazing experience.
Yeah.
And it pushed me all the way through the game into the DLC, and we beat some of the hardest bosses in the game. And I felt like I did it with somebody, even though it was so play.
Yeah, exactly.
That's and that was awesome. And I think that helped, because Bloodborne, I probably never would have made it through if I didn't do that.
I'd say that is interaction of like you playing a game and have somebody there watching you and chatting and giving you advice and just throwing things out there that you're not aware of. And even just the fact that there's somebody else there watching you and just having conversations, it's so invigorating to like gaming. Like, I could sit down and play a game, and yeah, like you said, it's like I'll get bored of the game for 5 minutes. But I mean, if I'm streaming and there's somebody there just asking me questions or talking to me about the game, you feel so much more into that world when you're discussing it and not just kind of playing it by yourself.
Absolutely, because we were talking about Bloodborne. There's a whole group of folks that like will just theory craft what certain things in the game mean because they're so symbolic. But I'll be honest. It was amazing to me to sit there for 4 hours one day and stream myself just going up against the same boss over and over and over again. And we made it fun, right? We made it fun where we had I loaded up some sound effects that some of my viewers could kick off. Like, okay, you know, again, you know, do it again. And we did that for 4 hours and nobody left. I couldn't believe it. It was amazing. To have people just sit there and just, you know, make fun of the fact that we are grinding up against this boss. I never would have made it past that if they weren't there.
Yeah, I think that's definitely where like Twitch really comes into its own, when the interaction between the streamer and the viewers, it makes it kind of like a nice cohesive unit, I find.
Oh yeah. But I guess, you know, translating that to other games, you know, Fallout 4 or Skyrim or any other game, you know, that could be useful. You might, you know, give that a try.
Yeah. See, like I go stream like WoW. See, WoW, I don't have that problem, right? Because I mean, for some reason, I keep always go back to WoW, and I've got like 10 tunes that are like between 80 and 100. So
yeah,
I don't have that issue with WoW. I don't know, because me and my wife played it for a few years, and then I've always had friends that play it. Now, not so much, because like I said, I've lapsed my account now, and I haven't played it in a while. But I've tried going into just, it's hard on Twitch because it's like, I see you in breakfast and it's like, man, you guys always have like a good constant viewers. And it's like, I'm not worried about the viewers, but it's like, because my time frame is so small for streaming that it's I'm only getting on there 1 or 2 hours now that I'm on nights, it's like screwing over my streaming. Like, we all made affiliate around the same time last year. I'm not sure about yourself, right. But yeah. Like breakfast and old man and like stupid bird and Gilbert, like we all pretty much like did it around the same time. And it's like, yep. And then I went on nights and it's like, I was staying up to like 2 every morning and streaming for a couple hours here and there. And it's like, now that I'm on nights, it's gone. There's no time. And that's why I'm like, I was like, before I got back into streaming like last weekend, I'm like, I've been wanting to do this podcast for a couple of years now. It's like, it's my way to like, A, it gets me back into like that world. And now the more I'm podcasting, the more it's making me want to go stream. So
it'll do that, man. It'll do that for sure. Because you're sitting here talking about doing it. And you just think, well, why don't I just do it?
Exactly. And you know what? That's half the problem too with my streaming. It's like, I'll honestly go on and I'll like have my stuff all set up ready to go. And I'll go into Twitch and I'll like, hey, you know, Joby's on, or Breakfast is on, or Tumble's on, or Old Man's on, or, you know, all these people. I've got my friends list there. And it's like, it's literally like, oh, look, it's my friends list. And these people are playing games. Hey, I could go play something, but I can go and have a conversation with these people as well. And it's like, you know, honestly, 80% of the time, I love streaming and playing games. But man, sometimes I just find myself popping into other people's streams and just watching them play. It's so hard getting that drive to go stream when you have friends out there that you can just sit back and chill with and chat and watch them play. Especially like for you, an example, like, when you're playing that space game, it's like I said, I used to play Freelancer a lot back in the day. And so when I see you play that game, it's like, oh man, that kind of reminds me of Freelancer. So it makes me interested and just want to sit there and see kind of what's going on in these generations of space games.
X4. Yeah. X4 Foundations. Yeah, I've been looking forward to that one for a long time. I've always been a space guy.
Now, is that like a series or is that an X series? Or?
Yeah. Well, they started like, I don't even know how long ago, 25, maybe 30 years ago with X Beyond the Frontier.
Okay.
Which I can't play now. Nowadays, I can't play it. Can't do it.
Yeah.
You know, rose tinted glasses and all. I mean, the whole idea, the company EgoSoft, I mean, this is the game that they make. It's just the X series games. This is all they
specialize in that, yeah.
Specialize in this one game. And I think they have a very particular vision for it. And it is a very, very complex space based economic simulator. Down to the point where, so if you killed all the miners off, as many as you could find, then you would end up literally killing your entire economy, because there are invasions that take place in the game. There's an enemy AI that's gone rogue, and they've set up their own economies and everything, and they will come and try to wipe the floor with all the organics, right?
Okay.
So if the major factions don't have minerals that are sold to their stations, then those stations cannot produce goods that lead up to replacing their ships that are lost in war. And the economy will die. And everybody else will die along with it. Every ton of mineral that you as a player mine and sell back to the stations makes those stations and those factions stronger, and including you. I mean, you're doing it for money, and you're hiring other NPC captains, and you're building up a fleet of ships, and eventually your own stations yourselves.
Right.
So that's the whole X series idea.
Now, can you produce other miners, or can you get miners from somewhere else, or once they're gone, they're gone?
I mean, you can hire people. You can buy a ship in X4 Frontier, X4 Foundation. The idea is you buy a ship, and then you hire somebody to pilot it for you, and you tell them to go and mine, and you can tell them where to mine and what to mine and how much to mine, and they will go and do that, and they will do it basically on repeat. And they'll either drop it off at a station that you own so that you can use it to manufacture things, or they will just sell it for profit.
So it's like a StarCraft.
Yeah.
Just thinking of the workers, you know, picking up the...
It's a lot like the workers, yeah.
Picking up the gas and dropping it off at the
factory. Yeah, and that's the lowest level of the economy. I mean, you can buy massive trade ships. Like, these things are measured in kilometers. And you tell it to go off and trade, you know, buy low, sell high. Hmm. That's the idea. And that's what you do. And there's people that spend thousands of hours in these games. Yeah. Thousands of hours.
Yeah, that sounds like one of those games where it's insane. It's intense. Like, it's too complicated. But I guess when you're into it and you kind of learn it a little bit by little, like, does it do a good job of, like, teaching that little by little? Or is it something that you kind of need to have been playing the other ones before you get into this one?
The game has done a lot better with this time around. Mm-hmm. So it'll teach you, you know, how to outfit a ship or how to move a ship around. Yeah. But their whole idea is to, like, think. Like, it's part of their mantra. Like, the company wants you to think out your moves. Mm-hmm. So, like, if I'm flying through space, you know, they're expecting me to look at the stations and what that station is producing and
figure out from there.
You know, start thinking about, start thinking about, okay, well, this station has a lot of this product and this other station over here has very little of that product. So they're probably buying it because they need it.
Yep.
So there's a trade route for you. But eventually once you buy out all of that product from station A, they're going to want to make more. So how do I keep them making more so that I can bring that product? And that's when you start thinking about, oh, well, I need to mine stuff or bring that station something. And you end up with this web of intricacy that is, I haven't seen that in a lot of other games.
Yeah, it sounds very interesting.
It is, but you can keep it small too. I mean, you don't have to do anything. Like, you to hire, buy yourself a ship and do it yourself. So you can start small. Actually, you have to start small. So it's really cool. The time I spent in it was very enjoyable. Patches to come out to dive back into it.
Now, you're getting your own, when I was watching you, like, you got your own fleet too, right? Like, you're not just commanding one ship, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I was commanding a fleet. Actually, I was building a station by the time we were done.
Yeah.
I was building a massive station. We were trying to, I had identified a couple of areas in the market that I wanted to sort of monopolize. So I started working on that. And then reading through some of the Reddit posts, I realized that, like, the economy was going to end up stalling out because the enemies were actually not attacking. And if the enemies weren't attacking, then nobody's going to end up buying any ships. And that's really what the economy is all about, is just gearing up to buy, like, to be able to build ships. So all of the production chains lead to those sort of products. Mm-hmm. So if nobody's losing ships, then nobody's going to buy any ships. And that means that the money stops flowing. And, you know, if money stops flowing, that kills an economy.
So now you're mentioning Reddit posts. So does that mean, like, is this completely online game?
No, it's a single player game.
Okay.
But, you know, the people on Reddit are talking about it and sharing their experiences.
Okay. I thought maybe, like, you could be able to tell, okay, well, this is happening in the economy right now, so it's going to have an impact on my, you know, but.
This is completely single player. Okay. My economy, it may end up drastically looking different than somebody. Okay. Yeah. So it's pretty interesting. I like a good complex game every now and then. But then again, I like to just get in and shoot stuff too.
Yeah.
It depends on how I'm feeling that day.
Yeah. It's all about moods, right? It's like, you know, like, some days I want to sit down and I'll play Red Dead and get into, like, all the side quests and just do everything there is to do. And that's like other days it's like, oh, I just want to go around and shoot people.
Right.
It's like,
tomorrow, I'm actually starting a playthrough of Yakuza, which is totally different. It's like Japanese soap opera kind of game. That is,
I mean, I'm going from X4 to Yakuza Kiwami, so yeah. It's like, hold on, guys. Well, we're changing
cool.
gears.
That's cool, though. It keeps it fresh, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And it's a lot of fun. I bet. I played Yakuza 0, and it was an amazing game.
Was that the 80s one?
Yeah, it was the 80s one. Okay. Really well done.
Yeah, it's the only one I've kind of wanted to check out when I kind of read about that. It had like an 80s theme going for it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you meet the game world's version of like Michael Jackson and Steven Spielberg in that game, and it's freaking hilarious how you do it.
Yeah, I've watched a bunch of the Giant Bombcast play Yakuza. It looked pretty fun.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he did a good job with that one. Yeah, when you're playing a game literally where side missions is to find the guy who goes around stealing everybody's pants. Like, that's a thing.
It's quite the sense of humor they got going there.
It's a really wild sense of humor, but for some reason it works. I'm not exactly sure why it works, but it really works well.
Yeah, like it seems to be a half decently popular game.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely check it out. I would highly recommend it.
I mean, it's no Fortnite, but you know.
It's not Fortnite. It's definitely a niche game, but
yeah, for sure. But it's like the people who like it, right? So
yeah, exactly.
Did you catch any of this Game of the Year award stuff at all the last couple of days?
I completely missed it. We were I had to do some stuff last night. Well, I had the my show last night. Friday nights is a big
Right,
big show we put on, so I didn't see any of it.
Yeah, I didn't even actually hear about it until it was over, and I heard that, spoilers, I mean, Red Dead didn't win Game of the Year. God of War did, but I don't know if you plan on watching it, so I don't want to spoil it for you. But.
Oh, no, I probably won't go and watch.
Yeah, so, like, you know, I was assuming Red Dead was going to win Game of the Year, but, yeah, God of War took the top spot there.
Well, you know, I don't know. I mean, what do you think that's wrong? You think Red Dead should have won?
Ah, see, it's hard for me to say because I got such little time in Red Dead and no time in God of War. Have you played the newest God of War?
I played God of War.
Is it good?
Went through it, beat it, and it was really good.
Yeah,
I really enjoyed it.
That good?
Game of the Year good? I don't know if I would agree with that.
Like, I know you're not all the way through Red Dead, right? So it's hard to compare those two.
I'm not all the way through Red Dead, I haven't even unlocked fishing in Red Dead yet.
Right.
And that's all I really want to do. I just want to go fishing. But I am enjoying Red Dead a lot. I think God of War may have won. Partly because of just the recognition that series has and the pedigree that it has. I don't know. I don't know if I would have picked either as a game of the year. But that said, I haven't really put any thought into what my game of the year would be.
Yeah. Now I see that it was going up against Spider-Man was on the list. I'm trying to think of what else.
Spider-Man was a good game. That was an amazing game. Yeah, I loved it.
I was looking forward to getting it because I was hoping that it would be something my son could get into, because like I've got like a bunch of shooting games. It's like I don't really want him playing these shooting games. He's really into Star Wars Battlefront, and I'm like, that's probably like the extent of like the shooting I want to get him. You know, it's lightsabers, it's like blasters. There's no blood. It's more toned down, right? Like I'm not letting this child play GTA or like, you know, stuff like that. So it's like. I want to try and keep it to a minimum, especially with violence and stuff. So Star Wars is kind of like the max. I'll let him play. And like a little bit of WoW and stuff, but it's a little more cartoony, right? So Spider-Man is kind of like, I was hoping that he'd get into it, but yeah, it's just the buttons, right? He's only 5 and it's still getting used to button presses, and he's got issues when it's like the timing based little things you got to do, and he just gets frustrated, right? So.
In Battlefront, there's a very clear-cut sense of good and evil.
Right, right.
And so it's not like GTA where you can just ride up on somebody and, you know, pop them.
Right, right. Like in Battlefront, yeah, he knows, like, oh, I want to be the, you know, I want to be the good guys, right? And they want to take out all these droids, right? So he kind of knows, you know, like, oh, these are all the heroes, and these are, like, the bad guys and stuff, and he's kind of saving the world type thing, right? So.
Right.
Yeah, he enjoys that. And, like, the only other game that he's been big into is Knack. He's got really into Knack. We would take turns playing, and he liked the whole, like, gathering up all the bits and making yourself bigger, and then played a little bit of the co-op number two, and so.
Yeah, I never played that, but I kind of wish I had. It looked like a really good game.
Yeah, like, it's, people always, like, poke fun saying, oh, you know, it's, saying, oh, you know, Knack never came out for PlayStation Plus, and just, it always seems to be, like, the butt of people's jokes, right, for some reason, Knack, because it was, like, touted to be this groundbreaking, you know, next-gen game, and then people got it, and it's like, it's just Knack, right, but.
Right.
Yeah, it seems like a good game to me. I mean, it's a good, you know, jumping game, beat-em-up game, and, like I said, it's one of the games that got him to kind of see able to sit down for, like, long periods of time and just, you know, like, hammer out these missions and try and figure stuff out, and controls were pretty easy where he could figure stuff out on his own, and it was pretty good.
Yeah, I never played it, but I know the gameplay that I had seen, it did get me interested, and I just never dived into it. It took me a long time to get comfortable on a mic.
Yeah.
Now it's always in my face.
Yeah, see, like you said, you have good long sessions where you're streaming, right? So you're getting all that practice, and, you know, so far my streams haven't been, like, that many people in there, so it's like as soon as somebody comes into my stream, it's like I'm all nonstop talking to them when they're chatting to me, right? But it's like I'm trying to chat when there's nobody in there in case somebody pops in. But you know how it goes.
Yep.
You know how it goes when you're sitting there for an hour and nobody's saying hi to you. It's just like, yeah. So yeah, my character's running. Yep, this is awesome. But like, as soon as somebody pops into your chat, it's like, hey man, how's it going? It's no problem, right? But everybody knows it. Like, every streamer in the world will tell you, man. It's like they have no problem talking. But it's like, man, when you're on there and there's nobody talking to you in chat, it's, you know, it's, you got to work it, right?
It is a little weird because it feels, even when people are in chat, you know, if they're not chatting, it still feels like you're talking to an empty room. But I've gotten to the where, like, I mean, my wife is like, who are you talking to? I'll be like walking around outside or walking my dog. I'm like, I'm talking to the dog. And she's like, why are you talking to the dog? The dog can't understand you. I'm like, you might be surprised. My dog might understand everything.
Practice.
Exactly. She's like, you talk a lot more now. I'm like, yeah, I guess.
Yeah, you used to, like, instead of just seeing something and reacting, you know, you're like vocalizing all those things that you're feeling, right?
Yeah, there are no secret thoughts in my head anymore at all. It just kind of comes out.
It's good. Yeah. My chat would probably like to know how that smells.
Yes, they would. It smells.
Yeah, two normal people talking shit about games, you know.
Hey, two people talking shit are some of the best podcasts.
Yeah, true enough, man. Hey, do you listen to the Giant Bomb cast? Or?
Every now and then, yeah. Every now and then I'll catch it.
That's pretty much my go-to podcast, right? And it's like, sounds like it's just four or five dudes just sitting around talking shit to each other, just, and they happen to be talking about games at the same time, right?
I think the big news out there is everything going on with Bethesda and Fallout 76.
Yeah, it's quite the shitstorm.
It is a shitstorm. Like, the bags.
Yeah, I heard about that. Something like they promised one type of bag, and then people got different bags.
Right. Yeah, they were supposed to be really nice canvas bags, and then they got these crappy nylon bags. But to make it worse, they had actually done a promotion with some of the some big creators out there, influencers. And they got really nice, like, canvas throw bags backpacks.
But normal ones to everybody else? Crappy ones to everybody
else? But normal ones to everybody. Now, the bags that they gave to the YouTubers and stuff out there, they were different bags. Like, they're clearly a different design than what was on the packaging. Yeah. So it was obviously promotional. But still, I mean, when you see these folks carrying around their canvas bags.
Yeah, you're thinking that's what you're getting, right?
Right. Right. Yeah, that's funny. And then the release of personal information through their customer help desk site.
Oh, I never heard that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they released personal information. Like, so if you had a ticket The scenario, as I understand, is if you were putting in a ticket for help with Fallout 76, like a lot of people have been doing,
and
you go back to check the status of that ticket, you might actually see somebody else's information in there. And somebody even reported they saw the last four digits of somebody's credit card.
What?
In their information. Which is...
That's insane.
That's bad.
That's like
it's not good.
It's one thing to have like emails or like names, but man, like credit card numbers and stuff, that's just going way too far. Like,
it's bad. Oh, like, what is that information even doing in the customer support site?
Yeah, no doubt.
I mean, come on.
That's crazy.
What the heck?
Yeah, I didn't hear any of that stuff. That's crazy. All I heard was the game issues, how horrible the game is, and people are trashing the game real bad and refusing to rate it and. And then I heard about this bag issue.
Right. Yeah. The bag issue, the personal information issue. I played the beta and I think they released like one patch and then the beta finished. The game comes out, I don't know, a couple days to a week later. Yeah. And like there was no patch between the two. So you're wondering, like, what did they do?
That's weird.
Like, I don't know. I don't know. Not a great situation for Bethesda right now.
So do you have the game?
I do.
Yeah. Paid for it?
Yeah, I paid for it. And I'm going to stick with it because I like Fallout. And I'm not going to, you know, I played it and I enjoyed it. But to me, it's not a Fallout game. It's like, I don't know, my experience in Fallout 76 was very relaxing.
Yeah. Do you get the same feeling when you play like Fallout 4?
Fallout 4 is a lot less relaxing than Fallout 76, I'll tell you that.
Just a lot less barren, like, a lot more populated?
Well, yeah, because there's NPCs in Fallout 4.
Yeah, and, like, you think there's... Fallout 76 would be the opposite. You know, it's online. You think people would be running around like crazy, and it'd be the complete opposite, like an MMO.
Right. Exactly. But there's, what, 20 people on a server? And you never see them.
Yeah, I mean, the world's
every now and then, bigger, I saw one or two people.
Like, the world's even bigger than Fallout 4, right? So,
supposedly. I think it is. I think it's supposed to be bigger.
To be on there with only 20 other people is just... Yeah, it's the chances of running into them is crazy.
Right. Well, you can see them on your map. You can see where people are on your map, but, like, there's no... Well, there is fast travel, but there's no meaningful fast travel.
Yeah.
You can go back to your camp and you can go back to your, you can go back to places you've been before, but it costs money to do that. Hmm. Yeah. But like the bottle caps or whatever.
Oh yeah. Just to travel.
Yeah. Just to travel. And like, who are you paying that money to? That's what I want to know. Cause there's nobody there to
accept it. It's like drones, right? You're talking to like robots and stuff, right?
Yeah. You can trade with drones, robots, but there's no living people. I don't know. But supposedly there's raiders.
Oh, other like NPCs?
There are supposedly raiders that you could see that like in the story there's discussion of people that have gone around like you know, killing off townspeople and stuff that survived. Hmm. But now I guess everybody is dead. So I don't know. There's not another living soul that's not another player in the game.
So you don't run across these raiders at all?
No. Not that I've seen.
But they're out there, apparently, or they were.
It's, according to the story, they were around at one point.
Hmm. Is this, like, have people gotten to the end of the story and, like, that's the case? They just haven't ran into these people, or what?
I don't know. I don't think that they've run... Well, I mean, Bethesda has said that there are no NPCs in the game. So I'm going to assume that no player is run into an NPC.
So, like, even NPC, they're, like, talking about, like, you know, people that you kill? Like, not just quest givers?
There are no quest givers.
Right, that's what I mean. So they're saying there's no NPCs, as in there's no quest givers. But does that also apply to, like, no NPCs, like, you know, like raiders?
Yes, that's correct. There are enemies, like, there's super mutants.
Okay.
You know, the stereotypical super mutants are there.
Yeah, well, that's...
But there's no, like... You know, in Fallout 4, you're running into raiders all the time.
Yeah.
Like, they've taken over buildings in Boston and stuff. Yeah. None of that is in the game. Like, you walk into a building, and it's either... Like, the enemies might be... the ghouls,
yeah,
or robots.
Okay, so you're still getting all the typical enemies. You're just not necessarily running into, like, you know, NPCs walking down the street or NPCs in the town giving you quests and selling you stuff. And...
Right.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, everybody is dead.
Yeah, it sounds like it makes for a lonely game.
It's very lonely. Very lonely.
Yeah, it's like when
and I think Bethesda wanted it to be vibrant and alive, and it does look nice, but...
Yeah.
I mean, running into another player is very like if you're just bebopping around, mm-hmm. chance of you actually running into somebody is effectively none.
Right, and that's insane. I mean, you're calling it Fallout 76, but when you do the presentation, you're saying, oh, it's like the online Fallout, and you're, you know, somebody who's paying for this game is saying, oh, well, I haven't seen anybody. It's like you're pushing right. online, but it's like, where are these people? You make the game so big and you make the server size so small that these people are non-existent.
Right.
Like, it's crazy.
Oh, and then there's the nuke situation. So at this point, I'm thinking the people that are still playing are pretty hardcore. They've gotten up there in levels and figured out how to launch nukes. Mm-hmm. So you launch a nuke at a place on the map, which could be an area where somebody just starting out, like I'm low level. I'm like level 12 or something. Right. So I might be in that town when the nuke hits, and now everything is level 50 and 60.
So what happens then? It gets nuked and they go up in level, or what's that? Or like what's going
yeah,
on?
Yeah, it's like it's basically like turning an area that you've been to before into like a raid area.
Okay.
So, well, if you're not in power armor, you die. Mm-hmm. And the guys in power armor that kicked off the nuke will basically come in and fight some more specialized enemies that spawned in the high radiation
after the nuke.
Right.
Okay, gotcha. So now you don't lose all your stuff anyways, though, right? Like, apparently, like, if you have a base there, you can take it with you now, right?
Yeah, you can move your base.
Okay. So even if you have it up and the nuke hits, like, you're not, you know, you're not...
Well, if you do that, you can move your base. You have to pay proportionate, I think, to how far you want to move it.
Okay.
And then you have to sort of rebuild it, which is done through blueprints, which is fine. That's not that big of a deal.
Yeah.
But if my base is near one of those villages or if it's in that radiation zone, I'm either effectively screwed on that server or I just need to change servers, which, I mean, that kind of affects me.
Why? Because that nuke is like such a big area that you can't just move it or it costs too much or what?
It's a pretty large area.
Oh, yeah?
Like, yeah, it's effectively like one of the little towns in the city. Yeah, it would... It nukes. I mean, it makes that area unplayable for the lower class, I would say.
And what does that mean? Is like that mean it just stays unplayable forever, or just for a certain amount of time, or
no, just for a while?
Oh, okay,
just for a while.
And then it goes back to normal, or
I guess so. Yeah, I guess. I don't know. I always leave. I always leave because like that's where my mission is taking me, right?
Yeah,
because you get a series of story related missions, right? One after the other.
From terminals.
It starts like as you leave, like
right,
reclamation day.
Yeah.
You get a holotape and it says, okay, well, I need to go, you know, to that town over there. And then you go there and you find whatever it is and it leads you on and on and on. But, you know, if I'm following that quest and I'm level 12, and I happen to need to go to a village that's gonna be nuked or has recently been nuked or something, I cannot continue with my quest.
Hmm.
But the world has changed in that area. Like, I can't survive it.
So like,
I can't survive just being there.
So, like, because if you were in power armor, you couldn't go back there?
If you were in power armor, sure.
Okay, but that's, like, not something
you're in
you come
power
across
armor.
A lot like you do in Fallout 4. Like, in Fallout 4, they're everywhere, right? Is that something less abundant in Fallout 76?
I've played a couple of hours. I haven't specifically been looking for power armor. I figured I would just sort of run into it when the time was right.
Right.
I hadn't run into it yet.
Hmm. They figured they'd give me
I'm sure I could go and find a guide and say, I could find a guide that says, oh, here's all the power armor, I'm sure.
Right.
But I haven't done that. Like, why would I want to do that?
Yeah.
Right. I mean, if it's really truly about exploration, then I want to I want to explore it and sort of experience it myself.
Yeah, well, it's the point of looking up all the details if you, that's like playing. That's like playing Red Dead, and then just going and finding like where all the gold bars are, just all the stuff that just makes the economy just broke in that game.
Right. That's another one we could talk about tonight if you want.
Speaking of broken economy.
Exactly.
Have you played the online much in Red Dead? Or
I dabbled in it yesterday.
Yeah.
Like I created my character and got through the first couple missions and got to free throw. And that's about as far as I took it because Rockstar's servers like kicked me off.
Oh, okay, yeah, issues.
Like you're technical on
Xbox,
issues,
right?
I'm on PlayStation 4.
Oh, okay. Oh, it must be breakfast. That's on.
Yeah, breakfast is on Xbox. Yeah.
He was mentioning playing. I'm like, oh yeah, we should go online because he said you had it. And I was like, oh sweet. And I asked if he had PlayStation. He's like, no, I'm on Xbox. I'm like, oh, of course you are.
I'm like, why, dude? Why? It's the worst $300 you've ever spent. Yeah.
I had mine. I bought mine for, man, I think it was $220 for the Xbox S. And it came with Halo 5, Halo Collection, and the new Gears and Gears Collection. And that thing sat on my downstairs for about 1 year, and I played it about four times.
Right.
Like, I wanted to get back into Halo. I liked Killer Instinct on there. But when I started using the UI, I'm like, man, this thing is so slow. It's like, it would piss me off just turning the thing on and trying to boot a game up.
Is it that bad?
Like, have you tried it?
No, I don't have an Xbox One.
Yeah, like, it's just literally, like, even the UI itself, like, I swear, every time they come up with an update, they try and, like, rework the UI or do this or do that to make it better. But it's like, man, when you boot up the PS4 and you're going through that XMB bar, it's like, that thing is, like, fast, you know?
Oh, yeah.
You want to go find your game or go to wherever you want to go on that thing, and it's no problem. On the Xbox, it's like the thing boots up, and they've got this, like, list of stuff, and you somewhat organize it however you want, and it's horrible. Mm. That thing lags, and it's like the UI on there is just horrendous. Like, that's like 75% of the reason I didn't want it anymore, and 25% because I didn't use it, I mean, but yeah, I couldn't believe it compared to the PS4, how horrible that thing was.
That sucks. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I buy a console based on, is there a reason for me to buy it?
Yeah,
like,
of course.
The game. Like, the games are the games there that I want to play.
Yeah, and that's exactly why. I mean, I was a big fan of Halo. I used to go to all kinds of Halo parties back in the day, right? So, if I want to play Halo, it's either here or the computer. And it's like, my computer wasn't the greatest. I didn't have this new computer back then. So I'm like, I'm going to get an Xbox and I'm going to play some Halo. And then, like, over the course of the year, it's like, yeah, I played it probably about twice. So.
Oh, jeez. Well, that sucks.
Yeah, I spent more time
playing it. That always kind of sucks because you have the hardware just sitting there and you want to play it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it looked good. I mean, when I booted up the Killer Instinct and stuff on there, man, it looked great. I love the way things looked on there. But, yeah, it's just, once you're in the game, it's fine, right? But it's when you're on the dashboard and stuff, it's just horrendous. And I don't know about you, but, I mean, on my PS4, I spend a lot of time on the dashboard. I don't know why, but.
Just clicking around. And
maybe it's just me.
Trying to figure out what you want to play.
It's because I'm on the computer doing other stuff, right? So I've turned on my PS4 and it's sitting right beside me. So it's like, spends a lot of time there on the dashboard, right? Whether it's me going into the store and looking around or friends list or just doing whatever, right? So.
Right.
And if that basic use is like laggy and like troublesome, it just makes for a overall crappy experience, right?
Yeah, I think PlayStation could absolutely improve a couple of things. Like, the friends list is a little weird.
Yeah.
It's a little wonky, and they have groups, which I don't even know what that does yet.
Yeah.
And which is separate from parties, by the way.
Yeah, I don't mess with that stuff.
I mean, neither. Me neither, because, one, I don't know what it does. I don't know. Like, I know what a party does, but I don't know why I would need to group all my friends together.
Yeah, like, unless you want to see, like, when only your Fortnite friends are on, or, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's, I don't know.
Yeah.
I do enjoy the party system on there. I mean, when you get a party going and you can, like, share play a game, I mean, I think that stuff's pretty cool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's good stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know if the Xbox One has anything like that.
I don't know. Not that I know anyways, personally, but they've probably got party systems in place, but.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. I've just never seen a reason. Like, I like Halo.
Yeah.
I don't like Halo enough to buy a console just to play Halo.
Now, what about like older Xbox? Do you ever had an original or a 360?
Yeah, I had the original Xbox and I had the 360. Okay. And I loved my 360, yeah, but I got the Red Ring of Death twice.
Yeah, same here.
So I've probably owned like three or four Xbox 360s. Yeah.
How is that not like everybody's story out there, right? I probably had my original 360 for like, man, a couple years, and I couldn't believe how mine never got the ring and everybody else did. And then sure enough, it finally came to me and I'm like, oh, of course it did.
I always got it right when me and a friend would come over and we're getting ready to play a game. And that's when it would happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what we were going to do. that was the time we were going to play. Yeah,
for sure. Always happens like that.
I don't know. Yeah. But I mean, the Xbox One, I have seen some comparisons between like the PS4 and the Xbox One.
Yeah.
The graphics on the Xbox One, for sure.
Yeah. And apparently, like this new Xbox One X, performance wise, is killing it, right? So.
Right.
So.
But there's nothing I want to play on the Xbox One, which is a damn shame. I would totally pick one up if they gave me a reason to. Mm-hmm. Don't have a reason to.
Yeah. Like when I had it, they had PUBG was coming there first, which I didn't really care about.
Right.
Torchlight, they brought Torchlight there, so it was pretty cool. I was a big fan of Torchlight on the computer, so what else was I going to say? What else is out there now in the news? Have you played Just Cause 4? That just came out.
I have not. I've heard it's a disaster. And I watched... Well, I heard it was a... I mean, it looks like fun.
Yeah.
But it looks like there's a ton of bugs.
Mm. I mean...
Like wild, weird, wacky bugs.
It's just... It's par for the course these days. Let's just get a game out there and we'll just fix it afterwards.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, but you're being expected to pay like
full price,
AAA prices
for a game that's supposedly done. But you know, look at No Man's Sky. I mean, that game's I haven't played it lately, but I mean, the work they've put into that recently since it's been done, it's like nobody would have paid that much money for it when it came out. But now you show all the things that are in it, and people would actually probably pay that. Yeah, I was found that Just Cause 4 just I had never played it, but I think I tried 3. And I just found it too hard to do stuff. There's just so many systems in place with grappling, and it's like, you know, I could barely like run and shoot, and then you want me to like grapple this and fly on this, and just too much stuff going on.
Yeah, I never played any of the Just Cause games. I did see Just Cause 4 like a couple of the bugs, and like literally. Like an oil freighter spawned in the sky and like fell on the guy's head.
That sounds like, awesome.
It was. I couldn't stop laughing. Exactly. But I don't think that was the intended operation of the game, right?
No doubt. To us, it's awesome, but the person paying that money for it who just lost that mission, yeah.
Cool. Good.
All right, so you can catch Jovia over at Twitter at Jovia. Catch him on Twitch, Jovia. Where else can I catch you? You got YouTube? You got anything else going on?
No. It's just Twitch and Twitter right now.
All right, cool, man. So that same here with me. It's, you know, DreadnautX on Twitch, DreadnautX on Twitter. You can catch out the DreadCast on Twitter. You can follow us there, and there'll be updates and podcasts. I'll get up in the morning or tomorrow, and we'll be able to get it out to everybody and shoot the links out there. You can download that on iTunes, Stitcher, all your, you know, favorite apps, wherever you... What do you listen to podcasts on?
Oh, I listen on Stitcher.
Okay. Yeah, it's something I don't even know what Stitcher was before until I started looking into podcasting. I just have some Podcast Addict app on my phone, and that's kind of how I get mine, so... But it pulls from the iTunes library, and we're on there now, so it's good.
Yep.
All right, man. Thank you very much for joining me, man. Like I said, it's so awesome having someone to bounce ideas off with and, you know, chat with.
Heck yeah. We'll do it many, many more times.
Sweet. Well, let's end this shit.
All right.
All right.
Good night. All right.